Good morning, Trinity family. Welcome to the worship of God and the enjoyment of the communion of the saints today on this beautiful Lord's Day. Welcome to all of you who are guests and visitors with us at Trinity. We're glad you're here. We pray that our worship of the Lord together will be greatly blessed by the Holy Spirit, and that our time together in God's Word and under the means of grace will serve to be a great encouragement to you and to your family to keep walking by faith, not by sight, walking by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, built it on the promises of God in His Word, and encouraging one another to go from strength to strength until one day we all appear before God in Zion. Amen. Before we get started in our worship and the call to worship, have you noticed it's a little brighter in the sanctuary? We want to give thanks to so many people in our church family that serve so that we can worship God and carry out the gospel mission. But thanks to Julie Lietzma. She was a great help with doing a lot of research on the right kind of bulbs to have in all of these lights. Jesse Vandermeer replaced approximately 300 light bulbs this past week. And thanks to Great Lakes, they helped us with a lift to go up all the way there. And then here's this from our brother Jesse. He says, hoping the brightness in the sanctuary pales in comparison to the light that we bring as Christians into our community. That's a reminder of Matthew chapter 5, the words of Jesus. He said this, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. And nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, Trinity, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." So let us give thanks and enjoy the brightness that we're able to come into a very bright sanctuary and be pointed to Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world, and give glory to God our Father as we reflect the light and the love of Jesus and the life of Jesus through the Holy Spirit in our life. And all God's people said, let us stand as we're called to worship God today from Psalm 113. Hear the word of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Let's ask God to bless our praise of the Lord this day and forevermore. Let's pray together. Almighty God and our gracious, loving Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us through another week safely here to this place. And so greatly blessed. And all of these blessings, Father, because you are the author and the giver of every good and perfect gift. And we praise your name. And we love to praise your name. We love to give you all the glory, honor, and praise. And we thank you that though you are a God who is almighty, sovereignly ruling over the heavens and the earth, the sun and the moon and eclipses, and all that is going on in the universe, you are God. You are in control. And yet your greatness is also seen that you look down upon us. You know us all right here by name. You know everything that's in our hearts, everything that's in our minds, our souls, and you love us. And you've demonstrated that because you gave us your only begotten Son, Jesus. And because we are united to Jesus by true living faith, we praise you and thank you that we are not only forgiven, but we are raised and seated with Christ in the heavenly places, so that in the coming ages, you are going to show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness, your grace, your kindness to us, and all of this in Christ Jesus. So we're here to say thank you. But we need your help. Holy Spirit, help us to give the thanks and the praise that God is truly worthy of. Keep us from worldly distractions. Help us overcome our flesh and our sluggishness, our weakness and our slowness to give you, God, our God, the glory and the praise due your name. We ask this all in Jesus' merciful and mighty and sovereign name. And all God's children said, amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father and from the risen, reigning Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself to rescue us, to save us, to bring us into the forever family of God through the working of the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. Amen. Let's praise God through the words of Psalm 113 as we sing this hymn, Praise God, O Servants of the Lord. Isn't this great? God not only saved us, but he gives us a purpose. We're not aimless in our life. We are servants of the Lord Most High. We are bondservants of Jesus Christ. Him we proclaim, him we live for, wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on. Praise him, you servants of the Lord. Keep singing in your heart, God is good, as you hear his word, as we listen, first of all, to his commandments for us from Exodus chapter 20, and then in the New Testament, we'll hear from Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. God is good. And God spoke all of these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. So how shall they live their lives in the freedom that God has given to them? You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and who keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor, do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male servant or his female servant or his ox or his donkey or anything that is your neighbor's. And then from the New Testament, Colossians chapter 3. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. God is good. Let's pray. Our glorious Heavenly Father, thank you that you have united our lives to Jesus Christ so completely that his perfect life was reckoned as ours. And his death on the cross for sin was counted as our death. We have died. We have been buried with him. And in him we shall live forever. Thank you that when he appears in glory, we too shall bask in that reflected glory and share in the glorious inheritance that Jesus Christ has earned. In light of all of this, we humbly confess the struggles of our minds. For all too often, they are not set upon these glorious heavenly truths. We don't always set our mind on things above. It's hard. It's a struggle here on earth. So often our thoughts would rather wallow in earthly pits. Instead of delighting in Christ and finding our glory and rest in him, Father, you know the times we delight in our sins and we seek glory and rest from our idols. Our minds are often focused on clothes and money and stuff and food and sex and relationships at work, achievements, even our own attempts at achieving goodness, rather than being fixed on the glory of Christ and his gospel. And even when we do become aware of the depth of our sin, we're cast down and we flounder in the pit of despair, as if our own flawed righteousness were what saved us, instead of running quickly to you to confess and repent and receive your forgiveness. Father, have mercy on us today. Holy Spirit, renew our minds by your sanctifying power. Transform our thinking so that our repeated sin drives us repeatedly to Christ. And change our outlook, our vision, so that our earthly trials and difficulties lead us to think about the surpassing glories that wait for us in heaven. And open our eyes so that we see one another as magnificent, awesome new creation constructions in Jesus Christ. And we know that one day the completion of this new creation construction project of you, Lord, will be completed on the day of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. So renew our minds so that we become increasingly confident that you will certainly finish that very same redeeming work in us that you have started. And you will do so according to your own plan and your own timetable. What a great salvation. And how we pray, Lord Jesus, that we would enjoy this today and that we would be willing and gladly to go and tell others of what a great Savior you are and what a great salvation is still being offered freely to any sinner today in this day of grace. Hear our prayers, for we pray this believingly, expectantly, humbly, gladly, in the saving and the sanctifying name of Jesus. And all God's redeemed people said. Can you take some good news, people of God? We're here for the good news of the gospel, as it's told to us in Romans chapter 8, verses 34 through 37. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who right now is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Jesus Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. More than conquerors, people of God, let us stand to sing in honor of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We're going to sing by faith. We believe the Scriptures. We believe what is told about us, that every repentant sinner trusting in Christ alone, not only forgiven, but more than a conqueror through anything we are called to live through by faith in this world until we await our future glory with Christ. We are more than conquerors over sin, over death, over Satan, over this world, more than conquerors in Christ. Let's stand to sing to the glory of Christ. Thank you.
Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we come to you today, and I always feel a little weird talking to you because it's such an odd couple that we are. You've been forever the gracious Lord of the universe. You've been forever being. I was created, and I'm also getting to the end of my creation. You know everything, and I know very little. You're all-powerful, and I get hand cramps when I read a book for too long. But we have a common love. Jesus Christ, my precious Savior, and your precious Son. So through him, I can come and talk to you. Before he came on earth, I couldn't. I'd have to get a beautiful lamb. I'd have to live and have beautiful clothes. I'd have to do something to get in your presence. But because of our Savior, I can talk to you every day. I can talk to you at any time. And I can talk to you now. And I ask you to help me through this time that I will show my love for you to this congregation. Because I'm kind of new to this church, Lord, I'm bringing my bulletin up here so that I don't miss what I should be praying for. The first thing I come upon is the Mexico mission trip. Nick Dykstra, Brett Ebels, Dave Vandercotti, and the missionary Scott Yorink are going to go to Mexico on Saturday. We ask that you'd be with them, bless them, and guide them. Give them traveling mercies, and when they get there, may they be a good example of Christ's love to other people. And may they smile a lot so that the people down there will think, all those Christians up north must smile a lot. They must be very happy to be saved. Now I'm going to talk about our church family. We have several who have had cancers, chronic diseases, Jacqueline Weiston, Nancy Grabowski, Joby Lammers, Becky Brinks, and Lori Rester. Please be with them, guide them, and hold them. That's what they need you. I talked to Nancy at length the other day, and we both agreed that when you get to the edge of things, you really just look onto God, and you hold on, and it's a wonderful feeling. I know some of these gals are younger, they have families, they worry about them. May they realize that you love them, you love their children, I should say, more than they do. And everything will be fine. It's your kingdom, and they're just part of it, as we all are. We see that Kaylee and Paul Pant had a baby. Thank you for that. We have our Christian sympathies to Bill and Karen Cook in the death of Bill's father, William Cook, Hank and Lisa Montgomery in the death of Lisa's grandmother, Hilda Parker. On Wednesday, Derek and Stephanie Stites' grandmother died as well. We ask for your love and guidance and care as they go through this time. May they and us realize that we all are going to face you. We're all terminal. It's just a matter of when. It's not a matter of if. We think of Dee Mettenkamp's daughter-in-law, Christy Cullenkamp, I believe I said that right, Dee. She had a successful kidney transplant, and we're thankful for that. We ask that you would continue to show mercy and that you continue to grow in health. We want to talk now a little bit about our church. We want to think of our Sunday school teachers, gym counselors, cadet counselors, how precious they are. Last week, the pastor said that they were doing the work of a covenant community by showing your love to the kids. We appreciate that. We also want to talk about our pastors. We are tremendously privileged to have two outstanding pastors. Most churches don't have one. What I like about them is when they get up in the pulpit, they know who they're talking to. But more importantly, they know who they're talking for. They're talking for you. And both of these guys seem to show your love so remarkable. And that's why they're precious to us. I would think that when they study and get ready to preach sermons, knowing them both well enough that they probably pause and say, Father, is this going the way you want it? Am I saying what you want to say to your flock? I trust they do that. I think they care that much, and that's why we all care so much about them. I also want to talk about a group that we don't talk about, the piano players, the organists. What a thrill it is for them to help us praise you. I know they put a lot of work and effort into, and obviously they do because many of them play very well. I also want to talk about our choir. I think our choir has really grown. I think it's much better than it was, and I appreciate it. They've got a ways to go, probably, if we want to look at it that way, but I think they're trying. We really appreciate their efforts. When we think of the world situation, it seems like it's run by pagans. In fact, it is. I think our state and country are run by pagan people. They seem to have values that we don't share. And what can we do? Peter tells us in his second epistle that the whole world is going to be destroyed, burned up in fire. So I can only say that please be with the people that love you and that are your own. I don't have much hope for the world. I guess that's one thing about being old. You learn that things don't work out so well. We also pray for our synod coming up. Our church seems to be in turmoil, and we ask that you would be with the people that go to synod. May your will be done. May it be firm. May it do your will. May we not be ashamed of the gospel. I'm about to finish my prayer, Father, and I have to apologize because I was doing something stupid. I had all these verses in the Bible, and I was going to encourage this church to be a better church. And so I'm going to read from John 15:17. These things I command you, that you love one another. If the world hate me, you know it hated me before it hated you. If you were in the world, they would love you. But because you're not in the world, I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hated you. Then also I was going to read about the tares and the wheat. Wilt thou, though, that we go gather them in? No. That's why you gather up the tares, you root up the wheat with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest. And at time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, bind them in bundles, burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Where I made a mistake, Father, was I was making it all personal. I was going to make it like this church should really get on fire because the world hates us, and we could be a light and an example. And then the Holy Spirit talked to me a little bit. He says, Ron, it really isn't about you. It isn't about even the flock. It's about God. We're hated because the world hates God. If we weren't God's children, they wouldn't hate us. We're important because we're God's wheat. It's not that we're important, it's that God is important, and it's Him. It's not who we are, it's whom we are. We're loved and adored by the most precious being ever, and that is you. And when we start thinking about you and wanting to do things your way, then we become better Christians. It isn't about us, it's about you. We love you. We honor you. I want to say something personal as I close. I tried very hard to love you with all my heart. I never did it. I never could make it. Till in a fit of, tears, and I found out you love me more than I love myself. You love your flock here more than we love you. And if we would just reflect that love, how far we would go. You're so precious. You're the only reason. You know, sometimes we say to young people, it's the most important thing you'll ever do is love the Lord. It's not only the most important, it's really the only thing to do. You're either with him or you're not. It is my prayer that everyone here would know how precious you are. We pray it in your name. Amen.
Our two offerings this morning are located out in the narthex, first for the general fund and second for the benevolence fund. Our offering this evening is for the building and maintenance fund. Our scripture for today is from Acts 20, verse 35. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, thank you for this beautiful spring day where we can come into your house to worship you. Please help the funds collected this morning and this evening to bless this church. Be with your servant, Pastor CJ, as he preaches from your word. Give him an extra portion of your Holy Spirit. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to stand to sing a very well-known hymn of the faith, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Everything that's going on in our lives, including even our doubts. That's right. Today we're going to be seeing a portion of God's Word in Matthew chapter 11 where John the Baptizer, the one who was prophesied in the Old Testament, would come to prepare the way of the Lord. Even he had doubts. But he had a great Savior and a great friend, Jesus, who reassured him in his time of doubting. So let's stand to sing to Jesus, who's here, who's heard our congregational prayer, who's heard our deacon prayer, and as we've heard and been reminded, who loves us. And let's sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus together.
Thank you.
I invite you to take your Bibles and join with me in turning to the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 11 this morning. As we're making our way through Matthew's Gospel, we come to chapter 11 beginning at verse 1. We'll read through verse 19. Matthew chapter 11 beginning at verse 1. What you're about to hear now is the very word of God, Matthew chapter 11, beginning at verse 1. And when Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and preach in their cities. Now when John heard in prison about the deeds of the Christ, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come? Or shall we look for another?" And Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. And the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. And blessed is the one who is not offended by me." And as they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John. "What did you go out in the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? What then did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Behold, those who wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you.' Truly I say to you, among those born of women, there has risen no one greater than John the Baptist. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if you're willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. But to whom shall I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to their playmates, 'We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not mourn.' For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, 'He has a demon.' The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, 'Look at him, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners.' Yet wisdom is justified by your deeds." Let's pray. Jesus, what a friend indeed you are for sinners like us. How we thank you for the Bible. How we thank you, Holy Spirit, for giving us this most precious, miraculous gift, the written word of God. But we need your help. So help us now to understand what you are teaching us about Jesus, about John the Baptist, about ourselves, about our need for faith in you, and faith to grow, and faith to persevere until the day comes when we see you face to face and hear you say, "Well done, good and faithful servants." Hear our prayer, Holy Spirit, for we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Are you surprised, people of God, at what you just heard? That John the Baptist struggled at a time in his life and ministry with doubts. Doubts about Jesus. Are you the one? Or should we look for another? John was a faithful prophet of the Old Testament. In fact, Jesus, as we heard here, said he was more than a prophet because John was also prophesied about. And that comes from the Old Testament, the last Old Testament book, the book of Malachi. In chapter 3, verse 1, it says, "Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me." Now, it's really interesting because in Matthew chapter 11, actually, the word changes a little bit. Did you notice that in verse 10? "This is of he whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you.'" This shows you that Jesus is truly God. It's referring to Jesus, your face. In the New Testament, "before me, the Lord." Jesus is the Lord. And John the Baptist was prophesied as the one who would prepare the way for the Lord. John was a prophet, indeed more than a prophet. He was prophesied about. Jesus had said that no one born of women was greater than John the Baptist. What does that mean? Well, John the Baptist was not only called by God to be a prophet to say, "Thus saith the Lord," to proclaim the word of the Lord that John gave him, but he was greater than the Old Testament prophets because all the Old Testament prophets, the faithful ones, were also pointing God's people to the future coming Messiah, the Christ, the Savior that was promised already back in Genesis. Although it wasn't as clear, but it became progressively clearer and clearer as the Holy Spirit gave the prophets God's word and the fulfillment of his promise that through the seed of the woman is going to come one who's going to crush the head of the serpent. That was Jesus. And John, like those Old Testament prophets, was preaching about the coming one. In fact, he's coming. He's coming quickly. And then John actually got to see the Messiah. And not only to see the Messiah, you remember he saw the Holy Spirit descend upon Jesus the Christ, the Messiah, at his baptism. John had a hard time baptizing Jesus because he said, "Oh no, you should be baptizing me." But Jesus said, "Allow it to happen, John. This is to fulfill all righteousness." He saw the Holy Spirit descend upon him, and he knew that this is truly the one. All the Old Testament prophets said he's coming, and now he came, and John preached about him. John was faithful to God, and John got to see Jesus, the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies. He was truly greater than anyone born of woman. But isn't this astounding? Because Jesus goes on to say that he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. What does that mean? It means, Trinity, every one of you here who have a Bible, and you do, and you can read more than what John was able to see. John saw Jesus. John baptized Jesus. He knew he was the Messiah, now come in the fullness of time. But John here is in prison. And in a short while, John will die as a martyr for his faithfulness to preaching and proclaiming God's word and pointing sinners to Christ. As you remember in John chapter 1, John got it right when he preached, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." There he is. See, that's him. And John testified with the great confession that he is the Son of God. That was before even Peter made the great confession when Jesus asked him in his ministry, "Who do the people say that I am?" Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Blessed are you, Simon. This was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but from my Father." Well, John the Baptist said that great confession about Jesus before Peter. This is the Son of God. But he who is least in the kingdom has not only this, but we have the rest of Jesus' ministry, miracles, teaching, and then his suffering and his death on the cross and his resurrection and 40 days of giving all kinds of proof that it really is him who died on the cross, nail marks and all. He truly is risen from the dead and then bodily ascended back to God the Father, seated at the right hand of God. And then we even have more. The Holy Spirit continuing to inspire the apostles, eyewitnesses to the risen Lord Jesus Christ. We have the book of Acts, and we see what the Holy Spirit continued to do as they proclaimed Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Messiah who died, who rose again, and who proclaims the kingdom of heaven to the nations, saving repentant sinners who put their trust in him. We have all of that. John didn't have that. You see why Jesus is saying, who is least in the kingdom? You're in the kingdom. How? Because the Holy Spirit, through the gospel, convicted you that you indeed truly are in need of the Savior Jesus because you're a sinner. What was John preaching? Repent. And John did that boldly. He did it unapologetically, and it didn't matter who came. He was preaching, you need to repent. Jews, Roman soldiers, even Herod Antipas. Herod, you took your brother's wife. That is a violation of God's commandments. You are living in adultery. This is wrong. You need to repent. And that landed John in prison. Faithfully preached. A faithful prophet of God, boldly, courageously, could care less about what people said about him. He wasn't swayed like a reed out there blowing in the wind. Okay, what are people going to say here? Okay, let's take a poll over here. I think they're going to like this. Nope. He preached faithfully, repent. Repent. Because the axe is already at the root. Judgment is coming. The winnowing fork is in his hand. He's going to sweep it all clean. He's going to burn up the chaff. You need to repent now. He's coming. He's here. He preached judgment. So in all of that, does it surprise you? What we just read here in Matthew chapter 11, Matthew's account of John. John's in prison. He's been there probably for months. And he sent some of his disciples to Jesus. He heard that Jesus was now preaching the kingdom of heaven. He heard reports that he's healing people. He's so full of compassion and mercy and kindness. He's rescuing people. He's relieving people. He's doing all these kind, wonderful, saving, gracious things. John is perplexed. John starts to wonder, who is this? And he sends his disciples to Jesus. Are you the one? Or should we look for another? So let's just ask a question, Amy. What caused John's doubts? This great prophet, this faithful man of God. Well, isn't it obvious? Where is he? He's in prison. He's in prison after being faithful to what God has called him to do. And no doubt prison cannot be easy, especially for John and this dungeon that he's in. And the reason why he's there. I don't think it's really hard to think that when you're in John's shoes here in prison, your mind has a lot of time, and minds in solitary confinement in a place like a prison can go to some very dark and depressing places and despair. I really don't think it's too far off to think that John might have even had being a human. Remember, the best of men are but men at best. And John was human. Perhaps maybe he was like, hey, I know Jesus. I know he's the Messiah. I'm hearing all of these reports how he's helping everybody, so many people. What about me? How come he's not coming to rescue me and bring judgment on Herod and judgment on evil people? And here I am in prison. John was not the only one to struggle with doubts. Moses. You can read about it in Numbers chapter 11, verse 31. Moses has all of these Israelites. They've been brought out of Egypt. God clearly revealed himself. And now they're grumbling and they're complaining because they want meat. God has been miraculously, remember, supplying them with manna. Not good enough. We remember when we were in Egypt, the land of slavery. We had all kinds of different food. Melons and leeks and cucumbers, all these spices, and we're having this boring manna every day in the desert, keeping them alive. And they're going to get meat. God says he's going to do it, and Moses says, get 600,000 standing men. More. Where's all this meat going to come from? All the fish in the sea going to be gathered together? Could all the animals slaughtered take care of all these? Moses has doubts. And God just so graciously tells his servant Moses, is the arm of the Lord shortened? You know, the same God who with a mighty outstretched arm brought his people, parting the Red Sea and brought them across. Moses, do you think that that same faithful God, his arm is too short? You think this is too hard for him to bring meat to his people in the desert? And of course, you know the rest of the story, right? God gave them so much meat, they were sick of it. Moses doubted. How about, what did Jesus say here in Matthew chapter 11? If you can accept this, Elijah has come. He was told Elijah was going to come before the Messiah comes. Elijah has come. Not a reincarnated or the true Elijah that left and went to heaven, but John the Baptist in the spirit and the power of Elijah fulfilled that. Now, what do you know about Elijah? Was he a true, great, and faithful prophet? Indeed, he was. Remember the big showdown on Mount Carmel? Okay, who's the true God? And there's wicked King Ahab and wicked Queen Jezebel and all these hundreds of false prophets for a false god Baal worship. And God reveals himself so powerfully, so clearly, that he is the true living God, answering by fire, burning up the sacrifice, even the stones, and licking up the water. It was poured all over it to make it impossible for it to catch on fire. Baal was falsely to believe the one who sends the water, and God just lips it all up. Because he created the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. And what are you thinking? You're thinking Jezebel's going to go, oh, wow, I was completely wrong. There's the true God. Oh, no. She doubles down and says, you're a dead man, Elijah. Because all these slaughtered false prophets, that's going to happen to you. And what does this faithful prophet of the Old Testament, Elijah, do? Runs away. And he's down. And he's in despair. And he wishes his life was done. Does this surprise you? to read that John the Baptizer, a faithful Old Testament prophet, with all of these privileges, even seeing Jesus, seeing the Holy Spirit, he is in prison, hearing these reports of Jesus' kindness and mercy and grace and power to rescue people. And he's wondering, and he has doubts. He's human. And what does Jesus do when these disciples of John come to him with his doubts? Listen to Jude. This is the little letter just before Revelation. One verse, Jude chapter, verse 23. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others, show mercy. Those who doubt, show mercy with fear. Show mercy to those who doubt. Where would Jude learn that from? Jude was a half-brother to Jesus. And he's saying, now show mercy to those who doubt. He learned it from Jesus. Because how does Jesus respond to John's doubts? Do you see Jesus scolding John? John, of all the people who should never have had a doubt, you prophesied in the prophet Malachi. You are the forerunner. You are the one who got to see me, baptize me, see the Holy Spirit. John, of all the people, you're doubting? He doesn't do that. He's so merciful. He truly is, as we sang, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and even our doubts we can bring to Jesus. And Jesus is merciful, and he says to these disciples, go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the lame walk, lepers are cleansed. Now we read this a lot, and it's easy for us, is it not, just to go, oh yeah, okay. Nobody in the Old Testament is recorded had blind, were blind and got sight. So we shouldn't go like, oh yeah, all these. No, this is new. This is truly astounding miracles. And the dead are raised. And what is Jesus doing? He's letting John know that the reports he's hearing are true, and he knew John would know this. These are found in Isaiah chapter 35, Isaiah chapter 61, other parts of Isaiah. Jesus is living and acting in accordance exactly with the Old Testament prophet. He truly is the one. And these miracles are in line with what was said about Jesus, so you don't need to go look for another. You're not mistaken, John. Yes, your expectations have not been met, but your expectations are in error. Isaiah chapter 35 says this, the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer and the tongue of the mute sing for joy, for waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. Okay, so far so good. These are all the things. But what Jesus did not say was verse 4 before that. Say to those who have an anxious heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance. And the recompense of God, he will come and save you. That speaks about judgment, right? That's what John was preaching. John focused in on God's judgment that's coming. And he preached judgment. And that was true. And then in Isaiah chapter 61, it says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he stops right there. Jesus in Luke chapter 4 said, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. This part of it is true, but Jesus did not say the next verse, and the day of vengeance of our God. Now that's true too, but Jesus didn't quote that. See, John knew that God was going to come, and when he comes, he's going to bring judgment and vengeance. But what John did not understand was the timing of God. When the Messiah came, he came to preach the kingdom of heaven, and he did. But there is another time when he comes, that is the day of the Lord Jesus Christ when he comes, and then the day of salvation is over. It will be judgment. It will be vengeance. But he came to seek and to save the lost first. He came to save his people from their sins. And this is why he's preaching and teaching. This is why he's hanging out with tax collectors and sinners, even though he's wrongly slandered by this. He's a drunkard. He's a sinner. No, he's a great physician who's coming to bring the gospel remedy to those who are sin-sick souls. And then the judgment is to come. Are you getting that? Do you understand that? Do you see that? So John needed to hear, this is happening, John, just like Isaiah said. And just as the scriptures say. So go back to the scriptures, check it out, see for yourself. And the judgment will come later. So John's erroneous expectations of what the Messiah was to do had to be corrected by Jesus. That's going to come later. And isn't it wonderful that that was enough for John? John never got out of the dungeon. That deep dungeon. But he did get out of the deep pit of his doubts. And he got out of it because Jesus was such a merciful friend and Savior, and brought him back to the scriptures and to the person and work of Jesus. And this is good news for you and me. When you and I have doubts, what should we do? What are we learning? Go to Jesus. Go to Jesus. What the devil will do is try to tempt you in these very, very vulnerable times, in difficulties. Like John in prison, the devil will be there to say, yep, you see, Jesus failed you. Where is he now? And tempt us to run from Jesus and go somewhere else to deal with our doubts. Do not do that. Go to Jesus. He will never turn you away. He will not scold you. He may lovingly rebuke us, correct us, but always as a loving Savior. Come unto me, all of you who are weary and heavy. Come unto me. And he'll help you. And then you go to Jesus in the Bible. You study the person and work of Jesus. You ask for the promises of Jesus. You stand on those promises of Jesus. And he will help you. Have you experienced that in your Christian walk? Like so many others have, like John the Baptist has too. And you praise him and you thank him that he is truly risen. And by the Holy Spirit, through the Word, he's there. And he helps us with our... He may not get us out of the trial that we're in. But he'll bring us out of the doubts. And he'll strengthen our faith. We'll see it for ourselves and confirm it. What a friend we have in Jesus. And that's what he... By the way, you know why one of the many reasons we come to church? There's so many reasons. You know why we're Christians together in fellowship? Because John had two disciples. He sent them to Jesus, and they went and told John. Blessed are you who are not offended by Jesus and not ashamed of Jesus. And when you hear a fellow brother, a sister in Christ who have doubts and struggles, or you have a teenager who has doubts, and you have a parent, you have a loved one, somebody that has doubts, and you do just like this. You bring them to Jesus together. And you go to God's Word together. You examine Jesus, and you bring the promises of God together. You bring everything that Jesus said. You say, this is what Jesus said. Remember, and this is what he did. And sometimes he said, it's not always going to be easy. We're going to be persecuted. And blessed are you to have those kinds of friends, and even more so, to be that kind of a friend who helps them out with their doubts and bring them to Jesus. Let's just end with this. Jesus not only reassured John about his doubts, he went on to praise John, did he not? He's like, hey, to the crowds, don't you get down on John now because he had doubts. Because you guys left your homes and you went on a long trip into the desert. And if you've ever been in the desert, even in our modern times, you got to really be prepared in the desert. You guys went out in the desert. Why would you leave the comfort of your homes, the security of your homes, go all the way out to the desert to see this guy, John? Were you looking for a reed blowing in the wind? Of course not, you weren't. Because you got plenty of those in your own hometown. There's plenty of leaders who will say whatever you want to say, find out what the polls are saying, and do that. John's not like that. So don't be too hard on John. Did you go out into the desert to find some guy who's wearing like really nice clothes, the kind like kings wear, living in luxury like they do in kings' palaces? No, you didn't do that because John was not living for this age. John wasn't all about worldly, goodly stuff. Now, you came out to see a real prophet, a true prophet, and indeed he was. And you see what Jesus is doing? He's praising John, his faithfulness. Yes, even though he had doubts, he reassured him. Hey, brothers and sisters, let's take this. Does he know you? Does Jesus know everything about you? Your doubts, as well as the times that you are faithfully serving him, even when it's hard, he does. And how glorious it's going to be when we're there with Jesus. He knows everything about us, and all by his grace, we are going to enjoy his word to us saying, well done, good and faithful servant. And we may be like, I don't feel like a faithful servant at all. I'm an unworthy servant. Nevertheless, Jesus knows. And Jesus, right now, at the right hand of the Father, what is he doing for us, brothers and sisters? He's interceding for us. Jesus is talking to God the Father for you and for me, for all of his people. What a conversation that must be. And we know, part of that conversation, that he's praying for us, that our faith would not fail, that we would be not offended at Jesus in any way, shape, or form, even when he doesn't meet our expectations. And we got to get our expectations in line with his word, his time, not our time. Blessed are you if you're not offended by Jesus. Blessed are you if you're not offended by John the Baptist preaching and Jesus preaching when he points out areas in our life you need to repent. Your attitude's not right. Your words aren't right. Your behavior is not in line with his commandments. Okay, God, you're right. Help me repent. Help me take up my cross daily, deny myself because I really love myself and I need to be saved from me so that I could be a faithful servant of Jesus. Blessed are you if you're not offended by that. And blessed are you if you're not offended that Jesus went about hanging out with sinners, never sinning, because he knew that if they didn't have the Savior Jesus, they would be lost in their sins. They would die in their sins and go to the judgment and have a Christless eternity. So blessed are you if you're at work and there's somebody there who's just grinding your gears and you're like, I think I'm going to get another job. I can't stand this person. They're so rude. They're so challenging. And God says, have you ever considered that God put you there because this person needs Jesus? Doesn't know Jesus? And he wants you to endure pray, love, and show this person how Jesus has changed your life and how you can be a gospel blessing to this person so that maybe, perhaps one day through your faithful witness, they too would repent, not be offended at Jesus, and say, Jesus, I'm a sinner and I need you. Because whatever this fellow Christian has, I need that and I need you. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so very much for the good news that you so loved this world of sinners. You gave your only begotten Son. You did it in such a way that through the years you had prophets foretelling the coming of Jesus, the Son of God, the Messiah, the Christ. You even raised up John the Baptist to be that forerunner, to prepare the way. He did so faithfully, and yet he was human, and he struggled when he was going through a really, really hard time. Yet you were so merciful to him, you reassured him of his doubts about you and your miracles, but also in the prophecies and the word. You know us too. For anyone here today who came to church with doubts, may this day, through your word, through your love, through your mercy, be a reassuring day for them too. May they go through this Lord's Day standing on your promises, assured that you're with them, you're fulfilling all things according to your plan, even for their life, and working in all things together for their good and for our future glory. When we will see you, John the Baptist, Moses, Elijah, and all of your redeemed together at the great banquet. And we will praise you and thank you and glorify you forever. In your most precious and holy name we pray. And all God's people said, let's stand and we're going to sing to God, all glory be to Christ, the three stanzas. And now unto him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority. Jesus Christ, who was before all ages, and who is even now, and who shall be forevermore. And all God's people said, Amen.